It's somewhere in your Old Testament, a part of the Old Testament that many probably don't read. So, if it helps, it's after Hosea, Joel chapter 2. And we are going to focus on verses 18 to 24. And I have titled the message this morning, Fear Not. And it's actually taken from the text. And you couldn't have missed it when it was read. Two times over, as you look at verse 21 and verse 22, the Lord says, don't be afraid. He tells the land not to be afraid. The desolate, barren land, don't be afraid. He tells the wild animals that are grieving, mourning, restless because of all this judgment taking place upon the land. He's telling the wild animals, don't be afraid. And of course, don't be afraid applies to the people too. So if you look at the context, the people in the time of Joel, they were paralyzed by fear. They have just experienced a locust epidemic, a locust judgment. And everything green in sight has been wiped out. And there is a total collapse of the economy. And then they are told that the Babylonian army is gathering strength, ready to attack the nation. And that put fear into the hearts of the people. And then the prophet says, looking ahead, there is going to come the day of the Lord, the ultimate day of judgment. And that puts fear into the hearts of the people. And so the people fear a threatened security. They fear the loss of jobs. They fear deportation, exile. And it was not a happy time to be alive in the nation. And the future looked very bleak. The present was already bleak. And in that dark context, the prophet burst through with the wonderful words, fear not. Now, I'm sure all of us, if we are honest, we have some cause for fear in our personal life, in our family life, in our national life, and of course, internationally. Things are not all blue and nice. And we all have reasons for fear. I'm sure if you jot it down, you would come up with at least three fears that you might have. I certainly have my fears. But God is telling us this morning, don't fear. And from this passage, just the five verses that we read, I'm going to give you six reasons as to why you and I should not be paranoid with fear. We should not be paralyzed by fear. Here are the six reasons. So the first reason is given in Joel 2 and verse 18. Then the Lord will be jealous for his land. Isn't it interesting? God is going to be jealous for his land. Now keep a finger. So let me give you the first point. God is possessive of his people. God is possessive of his people. God is possessive of his land. Keep a finger at Joel 2, and I want you to turn to Exodus chapter 20. As we probe this further, Exodus chapter 20, you may want to write this in your notes because it's not in your notes. Exodus chapter 20, and I'm reading verse 5. Exodus 20 and verse 5, the Ten Commandments. You shall not bow down to them or worship them. So, no idolatry, no worship of idols. God cannot be represented in any idol form, image, icon. And as we keep reading, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God. So, right from the book of Genesis, Exodus, we are introduced to the concept that the God of the Bible is a jealous God. He is jealous for his people. He is jealous for his land. Now we need to define this word, jealous. I'm going to do it in two ways. First, I'm going to look at it from a human perspective. From a human perspective, jealousy is a very negative word. It is something that we should not entertain in our life and system. So what is human jealousy, as you look at your notes? Human jealousy has overtones of selfishness, suspicion, and distrust, and implies a hideous resentment or hostility toward other people because they enjoy some advantage which we don't have. And if all of us are brutally honest, we have all have had feelings, emotions of jealousy and envy in our heart and life at some particular point. Maybe right now you're struggling with it. Your next door neighbor has bought a brand new BMW and yours is a 1995 Dodge. And you look at that new baby BMW and thoughts and feelings of jealousy go through your heart. Every time I dedicate a new car, I have a feeling of jealousy. Why is it that I can't drive this car? And no one has offered the key to me. Pastor, it's all yours. And you have that moment of jealousy because we are human, right? But now we want to move beyond the negative to the positive. When the Bible says that God is jealous, it's a very positive statement. So the meaning of the word jealous as it relates to God, it means to become intensely red. Your face is all flushed. It becomes red. It seems to refer to the changing color of the face or the rising heat of the emotions which are associated with intense zeal or fervor over something that is dear to us. That's a very positive jealousy. So as a parent, I am jealous over my children. As a husband, I sincerely hope that I am jealous over my wife. What does that mean? God has our best interests at heart all the time, and God is deeply grieved when we choose to act independent of Him. God is deeply grieved when I give my heart to something other than God. When I begin to love the world system instead of loving the Lord with all my heart and loving His word with all my heart, that's the jealous God. He wants me to walk in His path. He wants me to give my total allegiance to Him. He wants me to love Him with all my heart, all my mind, all my soul, all my strength. And when I walk away from that path, God is jealous because He knows now I am on a destructive path because I have chosen to follow something that is not in the best interest of God. So another way of saying it is, instead of using the word jealous, you can use the word zealous. God is a zealous God. He is eager about protecting what is precious to Him. God is possessive of you this morning. And I want to show you an incredible verse in Psalm 135 and verse 4. It's in your notes, but I'm going to read it to you from the Bible. This verse should cause you to stand up and start dancing. And if it does happen, it's good. You can't remain seated after reading a verse like this. Psalm 135 and verse 4. A great verse to mark in your Bible. For the Lord has chosen Jacob to be His own, Israel to be His treasured possession. Now you can personalize that. God has chosen Benjamin to be his own, and Benjamin is his treasured possession. You can put your name there. Doesn't it make you excited? Some of you are looking so glum. Even after reading an exciting scripture like that, man, you should be waving your hands and saying, wow, that's me. I am God's treasured possession. Even if my husband doesn't think like that about me, that's okay. Okay, a few chuckles, right. So the first reason God says, don't fear, is because I am God's private property. I am precious to God. God is zealous over me. God is watching over my interests. God wants me to walk in his path and to experience the fullness of his blessings. So what have we got to fear? Fear not. Now the second reason why we should not fear, coming back to Joel 2, and again verse 18, the second part of verse 18 says, God takes pity on his people. God will take pity on his people. God is a pitiful, merciful God. Last Sunday we said that God always acts in compassion. I love the words of Psalm 103 where it says, as a father takes pity of his son, so the Lord takes pity on us. And he is very mindful that we are creatures of dust. I remember when Jonathan was born and as he kept growing, every time I looked at him, there were waves of pity that went over me. Helpless, vulnerable, defenseless, he could easily fall. And here I am to guard him, to guide him, to protect him, to nurture him, to nourish him. And there was a feeling of pity. And even now, even though he's in his 20s, I still have that feeling of pity for him. Now, that's at a very human level. But now raise it to the divine level. God is pitiful of you because he recognizes your humanness. He recognizes that you are a creature of dust. He recognizes that you are fragile. He recognizes that you have feet of clay. He is pitiful because he realizes that you and I every day have to do battle against sin. He is pitiful because he knows every day we have to wage war against Satan. So he is a pitiful God. So what have we got to fear? Don't fear, because God is possessive of you. Don't fear, because God takes pity on you. Now, number three. The third reason why we don't have to fear is because he is the God of provision. He is the God of provision. So as you look at verse chapter 2 and verse 19, the Lord says, I'm sending you grain, new wine and oil, enough to satisfy you fully. And then verse 22, the second part, the open pastures are becoming green, the trees are bearing their fruit, the fig tree and the vine yield their riches. Now, you've got to see those verses in context of chapter 1, verses 18 and 20. In chapter 1, we are presented with a grim picture. No water, no vegetation under the judgment of God. All the streams and rivers have dried up and there is no water. The locusts have come and eaten everything in sight. There is no vegetation. The land is totally barren. The land is totally desolate. But now God says, I'm going to turn things around. I'm going to visit you with blessing. And I'm going to provide for you. And as I looked at these verses, there are five words that almost literally leapt out of the page for me. The five F words that you are going to fill out now. So how does God provide? God always provides in fullness. God is not a stingy God. God is an incredibly generous God. He is the God of fullness. Another word that you can use is plenty. The God of plenty. And what does he promise to provide? Grain, new wine, and olive oil. The Israelite society was totally dependent on those three items. Grain, new wine, and olive oil. They had all been eradicated because of the locust plague. And now God says, I'm going to give it back to you plentifully. So this morning, you may be struggling with needs. Your need could be material. Your need could be financial. Your need could be emotional. Your need could be relational. And your need, certainly, for all of us, has got to be also spiritual. And God says, I am the God of provision. I want to give plentifully. I want to bless you abundantly. He is the God of provision. Fullness. The second bullet, I want you to write the word fresh, tender grass for the animals. The animals were mourning because they had nothing to eat. And now all of a sudden the grass is going to spring up. And there is going to be tender, fresh grass for the flock to eat. I always love to hear that crunching noise when the flock eat grass. Have you ever seen flock eating grass? You know what flock I'm referring to? Flock. The beef of which you eat every day. I sometimes love to go to the northern country as we would do in the month of June when we take our teens on the camp. And I love to walk. I love to go into the farms. I love to hear that crunching noise of the cattle eating away at the fresh, tender grass. And I say to myself, eat away because you are going to provide me with good milk. And eat away because one day I am not going to complete the next statement. Because some of you might get a bit hurt. Fresh, tender grass for the animals. He's the God of provision who takes care of even the animal world. The third F word is fruitfulness. Fruitfulness. Now you can have the trees, but if they don't provide fruit, what's the point? You can have a nice mango tree in your backyard, but if it doesn't produce fruit, it is only good to be chopped down. And so God is telling the people, all your trees are going to bear fruit. The figs and the vines are going to yield their riches. You plant apples, you're going to get the apples. You plant oranges, you're going to get the oranges. Right? I love mangoes. That's why I love to use mangoes as my examples. Right? You want mangoes? You plant it. I'll super abundantly bless it. I remember back home, we planted what is called a dwarf mango tree. Dwarf. Doesn't grow to a great height, but man, the mangoes that came on it in season. And all the neighbors got jealous. But you know what? When the crop came, we distributed to the neighbors so that they would then not be tempted to come and steal. A very simple method. They were happy, right? And I still remember sitting under that tree and plucking these mangoes by hand and just cutting it open and you eat and you lick the fingers, you pull the next one, chop the fellow and Remember that, some of you? Some of you don't know what I'm talking about, but look for the mangoes when you go to the grocery store. That's what I'm referring to. So fruitfulness, God of provision. The fourth bullet is fertility. Fertility. Now, you and I know that this world is heavily dependent upon rain for a wide variety of purposes. So I need to tuck this in. When India is losing at cricket, you desperately pray for rain. Right? Mahat got it, others didn't. But leaving that aside, you know, when I was at school, when my school team was losing at cricket, I used to go to a corner and pray for rain. God save my school. Embarrassing to go through a defeat, especially at the hands of a weaker school. Send the rain, Lord. And I go out and look, and my goodness, the sky is blue. So obviously something was wrong with my prayer, okay? But fertility, God says, I'm going to send the autumn rains and the spring rains, the early rain and the latter rain. The rains are not going to fail you. And the parched, dry earth is going to soak up and drink this rain, and it's going to cause great fertility in the land. So the provision of fertility. Now the fifth word is a very interesting one. You'll miss it if you don't look at it. So it's given to us in verse 23. It almost seems a bit out of place to say it. Verse 23. For he has given you the autumn rains in righteousness. Now don't miss out on those two words. In righteousness. So the fifth word I'm going to use is the favor of God. The nation had been experiencing the judgment of God. That's why the rains were withheld. That's why the land was barren. Now God says, because you have repented, because you have turned to me with all your heart, now I can bless you. And I'm going to look upon you in favor, in righteousness. That's the God of provision. Okay, five beautiful words: fullness, fresh tender grass, fruitfulness, fertility, and favor. Now, it reminds me of what God has promised will happen in the end times. God is going to bless us with a 1,000-year millennium on earth. 1,000 years where the Lord Jesus Christ is going to rule this earth. You know what's going to happen during that time? That's when we are going to be restored to the original Garden of Eden before the fall. That's when creation and the creatures are going to be in total harmony. And that's the richest expression of the use of the word, the divine shalom. Now, when we say shalom, we interpret it to mean peace. But we don't explain it. Peace with God, man at peace with himself and with his fellow humans, and man at peace with his creation. Beautiful. The divine shalom is going to be expressed and experienced in its fullness in the 1,000-year rule of the Lord Jesus Christ. You know who the playmates of the children are going to be during that period? Not the gadgets and the toys that we dump into their hands now. No, no. The snakes. The child is going to put his hand into the hole of a snake, pull the fellow out, and the child is going to play with it, because now the snake is not poisonous anymore. It is like what it was in the Garden of Eden before the fall. Right? Unbelievable. If you read the Bible, what a golden future we are going to have. But prior to that is the day of the Lord. Right. So we don't have to fear because God is possessive of us. We don't have to fear because God takes pity over us. We don't have to fear because God is the God of provision. Now, number four, God will preserve and promote the dignity of his people. So I'm reading verse 19, chapter 2 and verse 19. And it says in the last part of verse 19, I love those words, never again. You know, after World War ended, they formed, I don't know whether they called it United Nations then, but something very similar. And the logo was never again. We don't want to go through the horrors of another World War. But not many years after that came World War II. And after the 5 years of World War II, millions being killed, again they came up with the logo, never again. Two beautiful words. But because we are all humans and we are sinful and our hearts are desperately wicked, till the Lord Jesus Christ is embraced as Savior and Lord, the human heart will never change. So we can only expect wars and conflict and more world wars. North Korea is now threatening to take over South Korea because they lost one of their submarines. And they are suspecting the South Koreans to have had some part in that. And they are saying, we want to take over Seoul. We want to take over all of Korea. Man, I don't know about you, but that's pretty scary language. And if the Korean Peninsula erupts in a war, it's going to impact you. It's going to impact me. It's going to impact the rest of the world. That's the world that we are living in. So, point number four, never again, God says, will I make you an object of scorn to the nations. We learned last Sunday, that's exactly what happened to the Jewish people because of their sin. They were deported, they were exiled, and the world looked at them and laughed. And the world dared to ask them the question, where is your God? The God who brought you out of Egypt. The God who brought you through the Red Sea, the God who dried up the River Jordan. Where is this God? Look at your pitiful condition now. And they made jokes. The Jewish people, Israel, was at the butt end of the jokes of the whole world. And God says, never again. Never again will you become the object of scorn, reproach, shame, and condemnation. So point number four is God will preserve and promote the dignity of his people. I love Romans 8:1 as it applies to us. Okay, when you open up your life to the Lord Jesus Christ as personal Lord and Savior, look at what the Word of God says. There is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. The shame has been removed. The reproach of sin has been removed, all washed in the blood of Christ, and I have been restored to dignity as a creature created in the image of God and redeemed by the blood of the Lord Jesus. So, what's the practical application of this? God is telling the people, because I'm going to remove your reproach, you'd better start fulfilling the purpose of your calling. So why did God choose and call Israel? So that they will be a light to the world. That they will proclaim the Messiah. They will proclaim the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. By the way, the Bible has been given to us because of Jewish authors. What a treasure, what a gift. And where the Jews fail, today God is using the church. Past 2,000 years of history is what we call the church age, where we are called to fulfill our calling to be a light to the world, a light to the community, to promote and to exalt the person of the Lord Jesus Christ, to exalt the Word of God, to put the Word of God into the hands of people. So I want to encourage you as a church that God removes the reproach so that we can become productive. So that we can become fruitful. Are you fulfilling the purpose of God's calling for your life? And if the answer to that is no, I have to very humbly say, you're wasting your life. Total waste of life. If you are not daily fulfilling the purpose of God for your life, to be a light to your neighbors. Now, the fifth reason as to why God says, fear not, reason number five, is taken from verse 20. God says, I will drive the northern army far from you, pushing it into a parched and barren land, with its front columns going into the eastern sea, and those in the rear into the western sea, and its stench will go up, its smell will rise up, surely he has done great things. Now that last expression, surely he has done great things, doesn't apply to God. It applies to the three instruments of judgment that God is using to chasten his people. So let's look at it. God of protection. So there are three distinct stages of the God of protection. The first has got to be the locust. The nation has experienced a locust epidemic, and God says, I am going to drive the locusts into the sea, and they are all going to perish in the sea, and there is going to be a terrible stench that is going to emanate because of the decomposing, if I can use the word, corpses of the locusts. That's the first stage. God of protection. I'm going to wipe out the locust army. But then the second stage is the coming of the northern army. So who is the northern army? The rising superpower of the day, the Babylonian army. And they are going to come and they are going to do terrible damage to Israel. And God says, I'm going to wipe out the northern army. The front column is going to be pushed into the Dead Sea, and the rear column of the army is going to be pushed into the Mediterranean Sea. That's all in the text. God of protection. Don't fear that army. Yeah, I'm going to use them to chastise you, but then I'm going to wipe them out. The third stage, which is still future, is the Great Tribulation. So the Great Tribulation, the 7-year period when this world is going to experience 21 terrible judgments, and I'm not planning on being here on earth during that period. If you're here, you can send me some reports to heaven as to what's happening, right? The only way to be sure that you're not going to be here is to know the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior and to start living for him. That's the only way you can escape the Great Tribulation. No other way. Now, during the Great Tribulation time, Antichrist is going to rule the world, right? And he is going to cause enormous hardships to people. But there is going to be a huge battle that's going to take place, the Battle of Armageddon, where the northern army, and if you look north of Israel, that's Russia. I was intrigued just last week reading in the newspaper, Iran again saying, we want to wipe out Israel off the map. And they are secretly testing missiles. So folks, when you read the Bible and you read the newspapers, man, everything is so current. So Russia with its allies, they are going to enter into Israel in all probability because of oil that is going to be discovered in Israel, and they want to take it over, and God is going to intervene. That's the third stage. God says, I'm going to intervene, and I'm going to wipe out that combined enemy force. I've given you the passage, no time to read it now. Go home and read it, Ezekiel 39, 11 to 15. Now listen carefully. It's going to take 7 months to bury the dead. 7 months. There's going to be a total widespread slaughter that's going to take place in the Great Tribulation period. We covered all this over 4 years as we looked at the book of Revelation in our Deeper Life retreats. So that's why everything is so fresh in my memory. Locust, Babylon, and then the Russian invasion. And God says, I'm going to be there to protect you. Now you may say, but Pastor, I'm living in this world where driving on the highway 401 is a nightmare. I agree. And that's why every time you sit inside your car, put your hands to the steering wheel and pray. God, keep me safe on the roads. Keep my family safe on the roads. Guide my hands as I drive. I pray that every day, sometimes 2-3 times a day. Because yes, we need God's protection, isn't it? I've told you this before. Toronto is not Toronto the Good anymore. Even this morning, 3 stabbings in the city. Now women are stabbing men. I mean, actually it's a cause for crying. Something is horribly wrong in our culture. Something is horribly wrong. If people are going to the extent of taking a knife, like what a schoolgirl did in Pickering, and just went on a stabbing spree. That's the city that you and I live in. And so we need the God of protection. So fear not, he's there. Now finally, number 6. Verse 21. You've got to underline this in your Bible. 21. The second part. Surely the Lord has done great things. Verse 20, the great things that are mentioned there were done by the locust army, the Babylonian army, and the Russian army. But now God reverses it and says, I have done great things for you in the past. I am doing great things for you in the present, and I am going to do great things for you in the future. So why should we not fear? Because our God is the God of power. Only a God of power can do great things for us. Now I want to just zero in on one aspect of the power of God. The power of God to change your life and my life. So we have a Christian organization that has renamed itself as the Power to Change. I like that. Our God has the power to change your life and my life. What do I mean by that? On account of our sin, the Bible says we are all slaves of sin. We are all hopelessly addicted to sin. It is very natural for us to sin. And the question that we ask is, who is going to break this deadly power of sin in my life? Who can change my attitudes? Who can change my motivations? Who can plant noble, godly desires in my heart? Who can give me the ability to love the unlovely? Only one person. That's the Lord Jesus Christ. He is the God of power. He can blast sin in your life. He can take away all prejudice, all hatred. He can put love into your heart as you have never experienced it before. Sad, isn't it, today? The number of Christian families where there is discord between parents, discord between parents and children, and we come under the label Christian, and it's not even happening in our own family. And that's why this morning I am urged to present to you the God of power, the Lord Jesus Christ, who can heal your life, who can change your life, who can change your partner's life, who can change your children's life. If you don't believe that, we have no gospel message. Right? So, a chorus I love to sing, you know it well, goes something like this. Change my heart, O God, make it ever true. Change my heart, O God, may I be like you. That's the ultimate goal of conversion. I want to become more like the Lord Jesus. You are the potter and I am the clay. Mold me and make me. This is what I pray. That's the power of God to change your life and my life. Now, the last part, the application, I'm going to do it at our AGM. I have to do a little devotional. So I'm going to do the application during the AGM. So it'll all get filled out, so don't panic, but it'll be during the AGM. Okay, so I want to now pray as we bring our service to a close this morning.